A few blocks east from the San Diego County Administration Building is a structure that used to be Old Fire Station Number 6. It started serving the surrounding community of Little Italy in 1915. In the 1960s, the firehouse was moved to what is now Fire Station 1 downtown, while its machine shop was moved to Kearny Mesa. This left a vacant building which collectors of fire station memorabilia and equipment turned into the San Diego Firehouse Museum. Pioneer Hook and Ladder Company is the nonprofit that operates the museum. And it's open for several hours each day from Thursday through Sunday for visitors to see the fire equipment and engines. In 1907, the owner of the largest building in town, the Cabrillo Hotel in La Jolla, requested protection from fires. La Jolla Number 1 is the fire rig that was put together and pulled by hand by the volunteer fire crew. If they came across a horse-drawn carriage, they had the option of hitching up the horse to bring the fire rig to the fire. Until 1913, this chemical rig was the only fire protection La Jolla had. In addition to the storage tank and extinguishers, note these two pointed brass decorations. They are actually oil-burning brass torches that would provide some light during nighttime firefights. The Atlas life-saving machine resembles a trampoline or large safety net. It's almost 10 feet in diameter, with a stretched canvas that is opaque to increase the confidence of those that had to jump from a building into it. It took a minimum of 6 firefighters to operate, but could easily be set up in 2 or 3 seconds. Invented in 1887, it had a jump height limit of about 6 stories. It did save many lives despite back, neck, and arm injuries sustained by the firefighters. By 1980, the Atlas life-saving machine became obsolete, replaced by ladder trucks that could reach greater heights more safely with smaller crews. Until the early 1900s, firefighters used fire grenades. These glass containers were filled with water or a chemical fire retardant and thrown to suppress a fire locally. They had the exact opposite intention of a Molotov cocktail. However, the carbon tetrachloride used was carcinogenic, causing damage to the nervous system and internal organs. The steamer engine here actually served in Milwaukee from 1903 to 1922. And was acquired by the Firehouse Museum in 1966. Although it has the word steam in its name, this 1903 American La France Metropolitan steamer was still pulled by a horse to transport it to and from fires. The steam was actually used to heat up air to pressurize water hoses when fighting a fire. Here's a photo of an Aaron steamer engine shooting water above the courthouse in San Diego in 1906. Fire extinguishers are considered a first line of defense against fires. They are used in the few minutes prior to the arrival of a fire engine on scene. Early extinguishers were buckets with sand or water. These stirrup pump models, used during World War II, contained water that could be hand-pumped at the fire. This pressurized military extinguisher sprayed a gas that would exclude oxygen and smother a fire. It was used primarily on aircraft because of its light weight. The 2.5-gallon extinguisher here covers the area with a foam blanket and had a solution in the water based on licorice. This red one in the center is a carbon dioxide model, good for use against oil and electrical fires. This 15-pound model is one of the largest handheld models and puts out flames with a smothering action. There are 2 engines on display at the front of the Firehouse Museum. This one on the left has a fender open to show the batteries inside. The driver area has a straight bench along with the steering column and gauges. On the side are hookups for hoses with more seating in back and a pipe for possibly a hose or nozzle. The engine on the right has a straight windshield with two forward-facing emergency lights, a storage box that doubles as a step, along with hose hookups and an assortment of large and small diameter hoses for firefighting. The Firehouse Museum has a collection showing firefighting around the world. There are patches from Portugal, Mexico, Sweden, Germany, and Australia, among others. You get to see how they identify their ranks or various fire departments. There are also vintage helmets and dress hats worn by the fire crews around the world, as well as a couple uniforms on display. In the main hall of the museum is a Seagrave pumper or fire engine from 1914. It has hookups for water, as well as racks for ladders, and a bed in back for carrying hose and other equipment. Next to it is another 1914 Seagrave fire engine that was put into service in 1915. This apparatus number 141 was originally red in color, and was restored and repainted white in honor of its debut at the 1915 Panama, California Exposition in Balboa Park. The Bill Kettner was the world's first gasoline-powered fireboat, named after Congressman William Kettner. It was built right here at 1572 Columbia Street, where old fire station number 6 stood, and served in San Diego from 1919 to 1961. The museum has artifacts from the boat on the rear wall, like its bell, gauges from the engine room, an igniter, spark coil, and spark plug unit, along with the inner mechanisms of a pressure gauge. During World War II, Chief Specialist Robert Ely saved a Navy tugboat from sinking with his ingenuity. Aboard the Bill Kettner, he had experimented with eductor fittings for fire hoses that could create a suction force by transferring kinetic energy from one moving fluid to another. With no moving parts, the eductor was very efficient and reliable in siphoning water from the sinking boat, saving the harbor tugboat and earning a commendation for Robert Ely from the Navy. All U.S. naval vessels from then on would carry the same eductor fittings as standard equipment. Ely's mechanical prowess was acknowledged, and he was assigned to Old Fire Station No. 6, which was also the home of the fire department's machine shop. He served here as master fire mechanic and assistant chief, and noticed a simple but concerning problem. Different fire companies had different thread on their couplings and hoses. They only worked in conjunction with their own equipment. If they tried connecting to another jurisdiction's rig or fitting, fighting fires became much more complex, or even worse, impossible. A standardized hose thread was needed across all fire crews to make things easier and more intuitive. Robert Ely designed and developed this machine to convert hose couplings to a standardized thread in 90 seconds. Not surprisingly, it was known as the Ely Fire Hose Thread Standardizer and eliminated incompatibilities between fire stations. When we hear the sound of sirens, we expect to see a fire engine approach and pass by. Although, not all fire vehicles are fire engines, What are some of the different types used by the fire department? The fire engine is the one most familiar to us. This one carries at least 500 gallons of water and has the pump, hoses, and ground ladders to fight a fire. A ladder truck has a main ladder that is extendable and driven by hydraulics. It also carries different lengths of ground ladders, search and rescue equipment, and tools for forcible entry or ventilation of structures on fire. A brush truck or wildland fire engine is intended to get the firefighters to the source of a brush fire or wildfire. They are equipped with four-wheel drive and meant to traverse over high vegetation and grassy brush. They often engage a technique called the pump and roll, covering a greater area by spraying water on the fire while rolling the vehicle at its perimeter. An urban search and rescue truck is not designed to fight fires and normally does not have a pump or water. It makes up for this by carrying equipment focused on saving people's lives. A typical USAR truck will carry apparatus like circular saws, cutting torches, winches, generators, ropes, floodlights, and the all-important jaws of life. At the opposite end of the vehicle spectrum is the water tender, which carries 3,000 gallons of water, roughly the same capacity as 6 fire engines. It acts as a portable fire hydrant supplying water to be pumped by brush trucks or fire engines. A mobile canteen is a supply van dispatched to major fire calls to provide hydration and food for the firefighters to maintain their energy levels and keep them well and healthy. This aerial tiller truck has a tractor and trailer configuration, with another driver on the back to steer the trailer to navigate sharp turns and tight traffic. The overall length is almost 57 feet, and the aerial ladder extends to 107 feet. An airport crash truck is instantly recognizable by its high overhanging cab instead of the flat face found on most fire engines. It yields increased visibility and allows for maneuvering through ditches or rough terrain to match the off-road capability of the chassis. This one from Station 28 carries 1,000 gallons of water, 130 gallons of foam, and 500 pounds of Halon 1211, a chemical used to put out fires. As more and more fire stations were built, the fire department needed a way to quickly view all fire crews and assess what coverage would be needed in response to fires or rescues. This personnel board shows the status of each firefighter, which battalion they are assigned to, whether they are on vacation or sick leave, and the names of their teammates on each particular engine or truck. On the southern end of the museum is a 1942 Seagrave aerial tiller truck. For size comparison, there is a 1928 triple combination pumper and a 1938 Seagrave heavy-duty pumper parked nose to tail. Both together do not match the full length of the aerial tiller. The 1942 aerial tiller truck is composed of a tractor and trailer supporting its 100-foot ladder along its enormous overall length. We can see the rear cab, where a second firefighter can turn the wheels of the trailer for maneuvering and cornering. The Firehouse Museum has numerous versions of fire alarm pull boxes on display. These were positioned throughout the city to notify the fire department of emergencies prior to the widespread use of telephones. When activated, a spring-powered wheel would turn inside the pull box, issuing an electrical pulse that would tap out the number of the specific box triggered. That electrical signal would alert the fire station through their alarm console, like this one at Old Fire Station Number 6. The bells below would ring, and a ticker tape would punch out the number of the fire alarm pull station being operated. Triangles on the tape indicated the digits of the activated pull station and were repeated 4 consecutive times. For example, this tape shows one triangle followed by 4, which translates to pull station 14. As the city of San Diego grew, coordination and communication across fire stations became of paramount importance. This dispatcher's console was used at San Diego Fire Department headquarters at Old Fire Station Number 2 around 1920. It has a switchboard to communicate by phone, and the similar Gamewell brand fire alarm system, with the addition of a repeater unit seen here in the center. It sends the electrical signal from the pull box on the street out to all fire stations simultaneously. On the subject of fire alarms, we often hear phrases like four-alarm fire. What are these terms, and how are the levels defined? The level is based on how serious the fire is, how much manpower and vehicles will be needed, what kind of fuel is feeding the fire, and how quickly the fire can be reached and extinguished. A one-alarm fire will have a response of 2 engines, 1 ladder truck, a rescue unit, and 1 battalion chief. A 2-alarm fire calls for double the equipment and firefighters, with a support vehicle and a hazardous materials vehicle. A 3-alarm fire triples the resources of the first alarm and includes a mobile canteen to keep firefighters hydrated and fed, along with a media relations vehicle to communicate with news reporters. A 4-alarm fire is considered a catastrophic fire event, calling up to 21 emergency vehicles and 6 battalion chiefs. An individual fire department may only see these a couple times per year. A 5-alarm fire calls for all available personnel, upwards of 20 fire companies, a dozen ladder companies, a squad company, a rescue company, and multiple supply shops, hazardous materials vehicles, canteens, and air support. 1 division chief, 1 deputy chief, and the chief of operations will join the 6 battalion chiefs already on site. There is an exhibit that shows the tragedy of Pacific Southwest Airlines Flight 182 that collided in mid-air with a Cessna airplane in 1978. At the time, it was America's worst mid-air collision, claiming the lives of all people on board. The crash site was in North Park, along the approach to the San Diego International Airport. The fire department responded to the 16 homes that were destroyed in the crash, and there's even a photo of the mobile canteen, its presence giving us an indicator the fire response was major because of the severity of this accident. Here's a map of the 2003 Cedar Fire, which began in the Cleveland National Forest, 25 miles east of San Diego. It spread across the Barona Indian Reservation and jumped the 15 freeway west to MCAS Miramar. In addition to the map, the Firehouse Museum has patches representing all first responders who helped. The origin was a hunter who was lost and started a fire to signal for help. It's a fact help did come, but not before the fire got out of control, burning 280,000 acres, destroying 2,800 structures, and killing 15 people. The estimated cost was $204 million. Here's another photo that shows cars on Interstate 15, right near MCAS Miramar. Notice that almost all vehicles are driving the wrong way to escape the fire by exiting the freeway using any available freeway on-ramp. The Firehouse Museum has a memorial honoring the firefighters who gave their lives responding to the attacks on the World Trade Center on September 11, 2001. On the scale we outlined earlier, this disaster was equivalent to 5 5-alarm fire calls, with more than 214 units and countless independent and off-duty fire companies responding. Of the 3,000 people who perished that day, 343 were members of the New York Fire Department, risking their lives to save others. Here are some uniform patches paying tribute to the first responders and parts found in the rubble around the World Trade Center. The front page of the San Diego Union Tribune presents a timeline of the attacks and gives a sense of how the entire country was affected. Here is a Maltese cross cut from World Trade Tower No. 1 with the code 5555. When telegraphs were used, five dashes followed by a pause and repeated signaled a sign of honor and respect for firefighters who gave the ultimate sacrifice. A surfboard above the hallway to the memorial commemorates the 343 firefighters. And a cartoon drawing shows the determination and courage of the firefighters' spirit to save everyone they could, no matter the cost. Three blocks west of the Firehouse Museum is a modern building with large glass doors. It's across from San Diego's administration building and houses Fire Station No. 2. There's metal artwork that resembles fire hoses and either water or sirens. The roll-up door on the side provides a quick exit for emergency calls. When looking down from the foliage on the third floor, we can make out the number 41 of, perhaps, Engine 41 through the white retractable doors. Although San Diego has seen more than its fair share of rain in 2023, it's good to know firefighters are always ready to protect San Diego structures, homes, and lives when fires do break out. The historical equipment and vehicles of firefighting are shown here at the Firehouse Museum in Little Italy. It gives us a chance to see the origins of San Diego's fire departments and how they will keep our city safe in the future. If you enjoyed this video, help this channel grow for free. Click like, share this video with others, and remember to click subscribe. Thanks for watching San Diego Reviews.